to react and save his targets. So it turns out that's actually quite a good ban, I think, for them coming in.
Yeah, I don't see any reason to change it. Neither do Fnatic, it seems, even on red side. And things will proceed as normal here. The Hecarim going to be taken out this time. So a little bit of attention paid to the top lane.
And there's a Rek'Sai ban, actually. Coming
from blue side. They're not willing to first pick it.
But does that mean they let Gragas go through?
It's possible. It's also possible that they may be trying to set up for a first pick Kalista or Urgot here, or potentially maybe not the LeBlanc. We'll see.
I feel like Fnatic still have to ban Kalista. However, what about the Nunu here? Because
what about it,
in the middle of the series, I started saying, oh yeah, I overestimated the importance of the jungle champion here, but Bengi on not Rek'Sai was very underwhelming. I don't think you can play a slow-paced jungler versus Fnatic. I don't think you can afford to do that.
And actually, XKT will be the one banning out the LeBlanc on the blue side in this game. So quite different. SKT trying out a lot of ban strategies on that blue side, going entirely away from their earlier support bans.
So Yellowstar gets the pick of the litter, but how much does it hurt the carries and their comforts?
They're getting Kalista or Urgot, though.
I feel like SKT either want the Cassiopeia first pick, or they have a plan to counter Forbidden's Cassiopeia, because the other choices of champions for the mid lane for Forbidden so far haven't been as successful.
Here we go. The Urgot pick is going to be number one for SK Telecom.
Shock the cameraman, he fell over.
I don't think this Gragas is necessary. I feel like Bengi is already planning on going Nunu.
Well, we will find out, Kirby. There's 30 seconds left on the clock. Gragas locked in for Rainover. He's had good success on it multiple times this tournament.
The question is, are they going to take that Cassiopeia away right now? It is a flex pick to a certain degree for Fnatic, although I don't think that it has...
You don't like to see it flexed.
I'm not a big fan of the top lane Cassiopeia.
Monty, not a fan of flexing from Fnatic.
No, at least not the Cassiopeia. A few other things we can check out. And there is the Rumble. Looking like the likely choice here from Fnatic. They want to be aggressive early.
And Gnaw's available.
The two biggest carry champions for Huni have been the Hecarim and the Rumble. The Gnar, pretty good performance from him, but definitely biggest impact has been this Rumble.
All right, we'll see what the picks and bans plays out. This is another slow-paced game. Rainover and Huni on their comfort picks, on champions they're expecting, and Marin will be picking the Gnar into the Rumble and Nunu in the jungle. So as expected, Azir is available if they wanted to run that in the middle lane. And the analyst desk was saying they much prefer Azir plus Nunu.
Yeah, exactly. You need Urgot's a terrible Nunu blood boil target, so.
I have a feeling the last two picks from SKT are going to be Azir and Alistar again, going for all of that tankiness. And they almost always play the Alistar with the Urgot.
They've got a perfect set of champions to surround Azir, because if Vivin goes with an assassin to try and punish Azir's squishiness and go for those kills again, this entire team that SK Telecom are setting up around Faker are going to be non-targets for whatever assassin you have, and they're going to do a strong job of denying him entry into the team fight.
Stern looks a focus on the side of Fnatic, Steelback in particular. That's him right there.
Yeah, not
definitely a lot of pressure on his shoulders. He's really stepped up with each and every game he's played on this stage. And Yellowstar will get his hands on Nautilus. It has been respect banned from SKT, and it's an even easier engage option.
I feel like both these teams have figured each other out really well by the end of the pick bans here, because these last few picks are not really surprising for either team.
And what will Faker be playing? Blind picking into his mid lane matchup. Had some trouble with that Azir. Could go for the Cassiopeia instead.
Played Ahri earlier, did not work out for him.
This really does put Fnatic in a tight spot. We called into question the champion pool, and we were thinking that the Azir was just a rumor. Does he have the confidence to pull it out in game five versus Faker? And was it even something that was rumored for him, or was that a Huni thing?
We don't know. That's we don't know.
Because with Cassiopeia, you can't really mess around in No Man's Land in a middle range. You either have to go assassin all the way in, or you have to go super long range and stay outside of that first tick of poison.
So this comp will be very dependent on Faker's ability to deal damage in some of these team fights, however.
If you're ever going to bank on somebody to be relevant, that is the man. He was 0-2-0 at the beginning of the previous game, ended 5-2-5, despite his team constantly being pushed around. I hope this doesn't work. I hope this doesn't happen, because Febiven's Cho'Gath was not impressive.
One of the best parts about players like Faker, these godlike players, is that game five, crunch time, those are the go-to. These are the clutch players that when you put everything on the line to have him be your main DPS source, he is the one that you have confidence in will perform.
And switch it up to the Ahri, looking to make some plays here. And SK Telecom, the problem is they haven't been good about playing safe and not dying against Fnatic's aggression. And if this starts snowballing for Fnatic, they will continue to make picks over and over again.
The big difference here, Nunu is an instant sight zone jungler. So Bengi, you really have to put your work in early on in this game and get the first line of vision down. Once you get that first set of wards, the game's become so much easier.
Well, here we go. We'll be cleansed on Faker's Cassiopeia in this game. So playing safe against the Ahri.
We'll have to see. Kobe, you touched on it. You either go all in or you stay way back. Ahri is about as all in as you can get with the mobility. Apparently, Deficio is a vampire, I am told. Thank you for that one.
That's why he can only cast after the sun is down.
That makes perfect sense. He has had the latest sets of games throughout MSI. Guys, you have one last chance to chime in. Who will go to the finals? SK Telecom, T1 from Korea, or Fnatic from Europe? You know what to do. Jump on Twitter, scream their names, and let's get into the rift.
So think back to game two of this series, because we saw Urgot from Fnatic and then SK Telecom try and play this Ahri. And Steelback was so good at flashing on top of the Ahri and swapping him immediately. And I'm a little bit surprised that Fnatic would make this decision, considering they showed how to play these team fights a little bit earlier.
I think it does. Sure, they can hear the crowd now, but I think it does have to do that pressure on the champion pool of Febiven. All right, let's see. Defensive start here for everyone.
Well, Febiven's definitely got confidence throughout the course of this series.
Oh, man.
Made so many good plays. We heard in the soundbite, if you ward for me, I will pop Faker over and over, and he did in a favorable matchup. Let's see if he can land the skill shots to rinse and repeat.
And what a wonderful performance from this rookie player.
Oh my God,
well,
yes.
You can't give these guys enough credit. Three rookies on this Fnatic team, and to come into this tournament and have a hard time early, but then take SK Telecom T1 to five games, and Febiven having to be in a lane against Faker and perform at this level, incredible.
I think that they had already proven themselves with winning the European split. And that was a lot to ask for, to
absolutely
not crumble under that pressure. But on the world stage here, something else.
Definitely the case. We'll step back and look at SKT. While they've been unable to handle Fnatic's aggression, the few games their scaling range siege has worked out, they completely suffocated the life out of Fnatic. This comp doesn't necessarily have the same conditions to it, but we'll see if they can stifle Fnatic's tempo.
Now, I need to go over the junglers. It's in my blood. Reignover, last time, versus Nunu. Whenever you're playing versus a Nunu, post level 3, Dragon can be taken at any time. Yellowstar, again, with the level 2 as well. All right, we may have to forego some of the early strategy here and look for some early aggression down bottom.
You mean like Bengi invading Reignover? Reignover's in trouble. Ice Blast goes down. Bengi looking to chase. There's no smites available. Bengi's going to consume it away. And that's going to put Rain over on the back foot early on.
And Bengi really with some creative jungling right here as well, mixing it up again on his Nunu. His early game pathing on Nunu has actually been quite good.
Well, is he going to cross over and try and contest the blue as well?
We will find out shortly in the next episode of Bengi Invades Rain Over's Jungle.
He's wrapping around this has, right here.
I know the feeling. This has happened to me. It's a terrible feeling.
This has happened
playing,
to you in game five
against
on the international stage. We'll find out. Rainover says, I'll have none of that nonsense. He goes in with a body slam. We do see him trading back and forth, but Bengi's going to win this one. Here comes Eddie Carey. That's a flash forward. There's no Acid Hunter yet. Summoning heal from Bang. The Ice Blast gets first blood. Bengi's on the board. And that might be some of the advantage that SKT need to keep Rainover down.
Nunu. We keep highlighting the Nunu, but he... You can't do that type of stuff against them. You don't have the HP to make that move. Yes, you're frustrated. Someone is stealing from you. They're taking things away. This is not yours. Get out of my jungle. But you can't afford to make those moves.
And this is a possibility. Bengi has a possibility to 4-buff in this game. And he can give that blue buff over to Faker now and start getting that lane rolling too.
If he opts into that one, Yellowstar continually trying to aggress on Bang and Wolf. Wolf down 50% of his mana pool. Not all that much harass gone back and forth. We'll need to see how that lane continues to play out.
And one thing here, finally SKT is starting to put a little more faith in their playmaking ability, willing to take that risk of flashing into that engagement and popping the heal to get it under the tower. They're starting to pick up their tempo a little bit to match Fnatic, which is something they've been lacking.
Wow, Rainover, he wants to get a barrel down, throws it onto Faker. No flashes or anything used yet. Febervin holds onto both his flash and ignite. Considering the cleanse was available, but Rainover, despite being counter-jungled so heavily, still looking to set up the ganks.
Feel like you don't see too many Nunus in Europe.
We don't.
And
you don't see too many Nunus in Korea
either. And you're seeing that here. Ah, come to North America and train with us.
The lords of the Nunu.
Derping around, walking in circles, slapping people on the back. When back rubs for everyone.
Right, back on target. SKT find themselves 900 gold up. There's a small advantage across the lanes. There was a big chunk of CS in favor of Faker, but Fembervin's been able to even that out at the cost of his mana pool. Yellowstar and Wolf just continually trading big, beefy support blows against one another.
This is going to be a lot of gold for Bengi, actually, when he goes back, and he's going to have a chance to maybe pick up. Oh, nope, just going for the Trailblazer right now. And there is a very, very fast Sightstone.
That's what we're looking for, what you need to do against Fnatic. And Nunu, the perfect champion to do that on. If he gets the first line down, then the consecutive wards to fill in those gaps are so much safer to place. And that allows Wolf to get in on the game, start roaming with the Alistar, put even more pressure on the mid lane. Faker playing very aggressively, as Faker does.
We'll see how things change once the respective lanes hit level 6. We've seen Rainover sneak his way into lane, but there's no equalizer yet for Huni. Still a couple minions away.
Can he interrupt the jump here?
Well, nope. Jump's already been used. A flash available, and Marin instantly flashes away. So despite Rainover being counter-jungled, he's still even on CS and has blown a summoner spell at the cost of a dragon. Appears to be the case. We do, however, see Yellowstar wanting to interrupt this one.
Are they going to TP for this? Now, here comes Huni.
Well, let's find out. Marin is, in fact, in the river. Huni has come from the Tribush. Equalizer comes down. Dragon is ticking away. 1,000 HP. Fnatic seem to be focused on the kills. Bengi and Wolf will get Dragon number one. Bang will be the target from Fnatic. Can they get the first kill on the board? It will be Febervin that secures it. It costs multiple teleports and a dragon. Fnatic prioritizing the kills over the objective challenge.
Also positioning on mid here, so Faker with some alone time. That's just one kill for Dragon as well. That's definitely a victory for SK Telecom.
Especially because Fnatic, one of the ways that they're going to be able to be competitive in the late game is by forcing that fifth dragon. So taking it away early with SKT scaling comp is pretty important for them because it does slow down that timer just a little bit.
And this makes it so difficult for Fnatic to pull off these picks that they want to make with Ahri and Sivir speed boost. There's just so many wards now on the map already.
Rainover with a sidestone of his own. Start littering the map with even more. 500 gold separates these teams.
And look at that. Marin gets a ward into the red side as well right there. Does a little bit of a pull on it. Doesn't want to commit to a steal by himself. Probably wise, but they're keeping eyes on him, seeing what exactly he's going to do. Bengi taking control over these Scuttlers, trying to get a couple wards down as well. On the bottom side, Rainover's coming in, and there is Yellowstar on a roam.
All right, so...
Well, Huni gets gnawed backwards. Marin just continues to throw every single thing he has at him.
Yeah, not quite into the turret. That's what he's looking for, a little extra damage there. But this is the period where Fnatic have to make their plays. This is the double tier for SKT. Oh, well, here comes some sort of a play.
Well, here comes the play you're talking about. That's a flash body slam. Faker does walk across the equalizer. We do see the dredge line pulling Bengi backwards. Wolf eats a chomp. Spare Rush is available for Febben. I think he's waiting out the exhaust. And it is, in fact, Huni that gets another kill for Fnatic. But what else can they get? Look at the CS that Febben is down and the alone time Marin has top.
Yeah, I'm not sure that that's really worth it. We're going to have to see how it plays out, but Marin is going to put some damage down here onto the top side. And there's a lot of CS being denied up the top as well. So a lot of farm missing. Baker.
Oh, this is 2v1. Returning the favor, Huni is. From the 2v1, he was put in. And it's Faker that goes down. No summoners, no petrifying, and an easy third kill.
Not even funny to watch Nunu counter jungle. That's just...
You're sensitive there.
I can feel your blood pressure getting raised.
I've been wronged before. All right, but that was a pretty big pickup there for the mid lane for Fnatic. To be able to take down Faker and get an extra kill for that, because you're right, Monty, that before that, probably not even worth it with the amount of control that they had to give up for it. And even with that kill, it looks like Faker will continue to play aggressively. He's down both summoners now, so he's going to need extra vision to do that. Luckily, they've got this Sightstone Nunu working for him.
Yeah, and they're limiting Rainover's options in terms of ganking as well, just because they keep taking away his buffs. So without that red buff, does make it a little bit more difficult. And they have eyes on him pretty much at all times right now, although Ward and topside did just go down. Bengi trying to look for a gank right here. Here he comes.
Haunting Guys is up for Huni. Equalizer available. He's going to cast that one. Turns his attention to Bengi. Oh. Here comes Rainover. The barrel knocks Bengi to safety. Mega Nos not going to pop just yet. And Huni and Rainover. I've seen these boys tower dive before. They might be thinking about it.
Yellowstar is already on the way up through the river. He sees the Scuttle Crab, though. That's going to be a detour.
Well, we'll see if he can get there in time. Wolf will be the first support to join the battle. Mega Gnaw, he hops in, he gnaws backwards. Rainover's under the tower, but he's not taking aggro yet. SKT get their second kill and turn their attention to Huni. Febben's coming up to support, and Yellowstar thinking about going over the wall. Does have flash available. Marin is low. Spur Rush is up here for Febben. He gets the charm
on a minion.
Thank you for that one. And then Wolf backs away. So Fnatic over eager and get caught up by a good roam from Wolf.
And again, Faker's going to get even more CS advantage here in this mid lane from that roam.
This is the danger when you are playing against the Nunu like this and you're getting counter jungled. You can't afford to be frustrated. Rainover, he's now starting to overreach, getting too close to the turret, too eager for the tower dive before Yellowstar is in place. He positions himself way too close to the turret, gets gnarred in. This, if you stay calm and you just continue your jungle on the small camps, it's actually not that bad for you. The experience that you get and the gold that you get out of small camps now, is actually comparable to what you get out of buff camps.
And SK Telecom as well, the adaptations that we're seeing here, just in terms of Bengi and Wolf playing so defensively, trying to preempt some of these tower dives before they actually happen. Because you can see Fnatic keeps on hammering on this top tower, trying to get it down, trying to make a dive and get some more kills. And they may be able to take the turret right here.
Does not look good for Fnatic.
Oh, this is a little scary. Equalizer's available. Bahuni doesn't have turret aggro. Bengi starts chanting absolute zero. Instantly cancels. An explosive cock only knocks Nunu away. Now Huni's in trouble. He puts the equalizer down, turns around. The exhaust is ticking away, reducing his damage. And the equalizer damage does not pick up the kill. Now Yellowstar's in trouble. Forced to flash. He makes this one count. Tries to get away from Faker. Faker does not have flash available, but Wolf does. Here he comes. Devavin connects with a charm onto Wolf, and Faker is caught out. Faker gets the kill, though. Wolf will be going down in reply. It's 4-for-4 in total kills, but 1-for-2 in that trade.
And what a setup right there, too. Just drawing Huni back under the turret, and then immediately coming in with the teleport to turn that play around. So Marin getting a little bit of an edge right there, and more damage onto the tower.
I do like the early Leandres from Huni, though, because Nunu is such a is all about health stacking, and he's just going to have thousands upon thousands of health very early on because of the Cinderhulk, because of his consume passive, and because a lot of Nunu players do run runes as well to add to the boost of max health. Plus, the Gnar already, a lot of magic resist, so that will be reducing the effect.
And Fabivin has been a force on the map. As we see, he does have 100% kill contribution for his team right now due to his roams. But it's come at a pretty steep price, not in terms of the turret damage, but now that Faker has caught up, at least in terms of kills, about 300 gold ahead so far.
We'll see if it comes into play. SKT, 2,000 gold up. And it appears they are countering Fnatic's playstyle. Bengi's counter-jungling is denied reign over the impact.
1,000 of that gold is jungler discrepancy.
That is absolutely crazy. For this point of the game at 14 minutes, it's been quite a showing here from Bengi. And you know, people, something I don't understand, a lot of people don't really give a credit to Bengi's Nunu play, but he is so clever with how he plays Nunu, and he is so damn annoying.
Well, we'll see how annoying he can be. He's going to need to deal with Rainover. Looks like there's a teleport coming in from Huni. He should be able to make it unless the Gnar interrupts it. Huni has arrived. They've turned onto Bang. Bang is running towards the tower. The auto attack plus the tower plus the equalizer gets a kill. That's a lot of investment for that kill, but it gives them a numbers advantage on the next dragon.
That certainly does, and a risky play to make there, considering they knew that there was a Gragas in the river, and Marin did not have his teleport available, so they're going to have to be content with trading this top lane turret for the first dragon for Fnatic.
Are they? Bengi looks like he wants to...
No, I don't think he wants to do it.
Chase him out. All right.
No, dragons traded. Fnatic will be happy with that one. The gold lead should increase for SKT. However, Marin is actually backed away from that top lane. Not shoving it in just yet. The one thing you have to highlight, when Fnatic wins, it's oftentimes behind Huni's charge. 3-1-1.
Actually, that top lane turret he left at 7 HP. Kind of messed up the minion wave right there, so got a little bit overeager in terms of denying CS.
He did that on purpose. He wanted to go back for the local gold, too. Just keeping his buried treasure up in the top lane. I'll go get it at a later date.
Marin confirmed pirate.
we'll see how long that tower does stand. A breath of fresh air would take it down. Spur Rush forced by the Yeti.
Now, are they going to dive this or make some sort of play onto the top side with how low in HP that turret is? Fabivin falling back just a little bit here. Fabivin doesn't have that ultimate available to him.
Well, wow, another red buff steal.
Jeez.
This could be the third one if Bengi and SKT can secure it. It looks like they're going to play this one relatively safe. Dancing around.
Fabivin doesn't have his ult here, so SKT looks like they don't want to chance it.
So Rainover gets his hands on his first red buff of game number 5, but Fnatic are still 2k down. SKT are now the ones that are in control. They are playing their tempo, their game, and making Fnatic dance to their beat.
And Fnatic has to start making picks. They must make picks in this game. Otherwise, they're going to be outscaled, and they're simply just not going to have the damage to deal with SK Telecom's composition.
The tier trough has almost expired here. Fully stacking up very close here for both Urgot and Cassiopeia.
We'll see who can get there first. So with the tower and the massive CS advantages across the lanes. 20 top, 50 in the middle, 20 in the AD carry role, 20 in the jungle as well. This is more reminiscent of yesterday's battle in the group stage. But the local hometown crowd, okay, let me rephrase that. The local LCS crowd, the local LCS crowd getting behind Fnatic.
I know you're used to casting
League. Good imagine.
If you're casting League, it doesn't always mean you're in Europe.
Yeah, it's a good point. I get baited by the European team. Right, Fnatic, what do they have to do to claw back this lead? They are slowly losing complete control as SKT have got towers, is pushing the lanes, getting the item power spikes are about to kick in.
And they've successfully avoided where Fnatic was the strongest in their couple of losses before. So Fnatic really going to have to come up with some spectacular team fights, I think, to take this one home. But SK Telecom, they're just playing this ultra-safe game, and the Nunu really working out well for them in this one. And as bad as Bengi was last game on Sejuani, he very much turned it around.
This is exactly why. Every breath that I mentioned Rek'Sai in for this, Nunu is right behind it in the same breath. Then Fnatic are a team that experienced it already.
Yeah, they did indeed.
We'll see whether or not they've learned enough to bounce back, because at the moment, Reinova's really struggling. Still 20 CS down. Gold disparity, still 1,000 gold separating them.
What they should do is do their best to clear out their side of the jungle, defensively ward, and then try and capitalize on these aggressive moves that SKT continue to make. Try and make your pick in your territory.
Well, Bengi is going to secure the blue buff. The charm goes wide, so Fnatic unable to make the team fight happen while simultaneously losing the buff. They lose the bottom tower, and SKT now have a 4,000 gold lead. At 20 minutes, towers down. They already owned Fnatic's jungle, and now there's no towers for Fnatic to fall back to.
And now Huni's teleport is up, so maybe they can find something to do right here. But as soon as that happens, everyone pulls back on SK Telecom to the turret, so they don't want to give Huni the timing or the opportunity in order to make one of those big Huni plays.
Minutes and 10 until Dragon. Maybe that's where Fnatic want to dig in. That might be where they fight. That might be where they want to hold them. I don't quite know if they have the strength of Leonidas's 300 to dig deep just yet.
Yeah.
Well, they don't have stealth on their side because their entire jungle on both sides is lit up by SKT wards.
Well, I'd like to point out
they're just going to do Baron.
Baron is 20 seconds old, and Faker and Bengi and Bang are nom-nom-nomming the giant worm.
Yeah, no.
And that's that!
Same trick as Fnatic last game. Look at that, right after 20 minutes, we see that Cassiopeia. There is the scrying.
He waited for it! Throws down the equalizer in reverse. I think that's still going to be a dead Huni. About to overheat. Cute attempt, but too little and too late. SKT. Nearly 6,000 gold up. This is now their game to lose.
And that vision control really doing work. I mean, so much knowledge about the enemy. And they can go ahead and just three-man it right there. The Nunu not really going to lose that much health because he can keep consuming. And Faker
like,
Cassiopeia,
he must have 3,000 by now.
Twin Fangs.
Okay, 2,800. He's not quite there yet. 20 minutes into the game.
That's close enough.
And he's got, you know, he's gotten that utility build. He's got the sight stone. He's got it. He's working towards a magic resist aura for the team as well.
So Dragon number two secured. And Fnatic are now the ones that have to defend. Fnatic are now in the same position SKT were in the very previous game. We'll see if they can hold out. Early Void Staff for Febiven as well. After the Marilla Nomicon. Feeling the pinch.
Yep.
Yeah, definitely. That's I need to make some plays right now.
Discount store. What's on sale?
What is a dash that refers to it as thrift shopping? One of the guys on the analyst desk. Sorry for not knowing exactly which one of you has said it. My bad. Locket of the Iron Solari completed now for Bengi. And for SKT, with the mid-outer turret, only one remaining, and the fact that Bengi just lives in Rainover's jungle, it's a matter of time before that falls.
Yeah, the Locket completion is pretty huge against the double AP composition that Fnatic really needs that burst as well. Their sustained damage, not so awesome this game.
Yeah, and they even have the AP jungler as well, so if it's the Sivir, very low percent chance to crit, it's really the only thing that's going to hurt.
As it stands, the tower does fall. Fnatic now need to prove they are worthy of the finals. The gold lead keeps increasing. SKT won yesterday with a 10,000 gold deficit, turning the game around, the sign of a truly great team.
Fnatic have what it takes. Certainly put on an amazing display here tonight.
Absolutely.
Pushing SK Telecom to their limits.
Well, we'll find out if this is the fight. The barrel throws Bengi to the back line. They've traded junglers for junglers, but SKT secure the tower. Fnatic taking what they can get. But can they hold off? Baron empowered minions still pouring through. This Marin takes a few more laser blasts than I think he was anticipating.
Killed Nunu, worth it.
Oh, SK Telecom, too, coming into this game, I mean, I would be so nervous after that last loss, especially considering how badly they were beaten up in the early game by Fnatic. But they came in so calm and collected and clear-headed in terms of what they were going to do, what their strategy was going to be in this particular game. And Bengi just pulling out this Nunu and finding all the ways to harass and keep Rainover down early, preventing him from making those plays on the map. So.
Kobe, you talked about the gas pedal from Fnatic being all the way in the floor in the previous game. Bengi is borrowing the same engine. And another buff steal. Fnatic, I think, have only secured one of their red buffs.
Yes.
I think we have to get that confirmed from observers.
Whoa.
That's a flash petrifying gaze. Faker wants Huni. He's going to get him. Twin fangs was all that was required in the slow from that ulti.
Does enough work right there. You close that gap just a little bit, and if Huni's all by himself, then he will fall, especially Faker with this massive farm advantage at this stage, just doing a tremendous amount of damage, and Huni having no magic resist and no Zhonya's to deal with it.
Yeah, I mean, Yellowstar was only four steps away. Too far, because it only takes three Twin Fangs.
I can just see Spawn, Crumbs, and Zyrene doing the Zyrene dance on the analyst desk. As they predicted SKT to do exactly this. Just shy of 10,000 gold. Fnatic are so reliant on Steelback getting this wave clear. There is a tiny, tiny chance, but truthfully, SKT.
Was Crumbs the one who changed his vote, though?
Yes, Crumbs like, flip-flopped.
How do you even do that? You don't win either way if you change your vote.
I don't question the prophet's doubtful thoughts. I go to his original prediction. The one true prophet.
Changing your prediction defeats the entire purpose of predicting.
That's why it's null and void.
Or
why
does it
doesn't get counted.
He's the one who's always gives the caveat with his prediction too, so.
Which is just the chicken's way of predicting.
Whoa. He can't defend himself.
Oh,
can you calm down?
Petrifying Gaze did not connect, and Huni's going to put the Equalizer down. The barrel throws him off the Equalizer, and the Flame Spitter plus the barrel get a kill, but how many resources were invested just to take that down?
Hey, a pick's a pick. You got one of the main DPS sources off the map. You buy yourself a small amount of breathing room. Maybe try and fight the Vision War a little bit.
Yeah, if there's any way they get back into the game, they have to keep doing things like that. So a bit of a reckless all-in there from Faker.
To be fair, it's something that SKT have done multiple times this series. When they do have a lead, when they are playing individually, getting caught out from time to time. As we see, Bengi has crested the 3,000 hit point limit. It's like... He has a lot of health.
Oh, believe me, that's not the limit to Nunu's health pool.
Well, Marin is going to run down Huni. We've seen this before. Huni had an hourglass last time. He has an hourglass this time. Marin's going to opt not to commit.
Sound like you don't like the 5,000 HP Cinder Hulk Nunu's there, Kobe.
I've grown a little tired of
Well, Febben again forced a Spirit Rush defensively.
I gotta be honest though, I used him to gain ELO.
See, this is why.
I'll admit it.
The honest truth comes out. Confessions of a Kobe.
All right, well, let's see if SKT Bengi can use him to gain entry into the finals. So far, great performance from him. Pressure from very early on. And they continue the chain of red buff steals. Well, it was broken in the middle, but...
Yeah, they've only given up one red buff and one blue buff so far this game. Two Fnatic of theirs, I mean. So, taking pretty much everything and now giving it... Here's a TP on the
B word. How big is the B word? Hooney's throwing down the equalizer. Bengi's channeling the absolute zero. We do see the position reverser swapping into the pit. Now, Baron has been peeled away. The first victim of the fight is Hooney, and Febben's trying to fight, but he's trying to get in, and there's no targets yet. We do see Bengi continue to stick around on Baron, and Marin stuns up to the dual lane of Fnatic in retreat, and it's too little, it's too late. SKT have Baron number two. They've got themselves kills on the board. Marin's looking for more. He should be able to run down Yellowstar, and he does! Two kills, two Barons. They're looking for the third win, and they're looking to knock Fnatic out.
And they're just going to start the split push right here. Febben intelligently goes to that turret to clear out the wave as fast as he possibly can, but Marin is around the backside just autoing the turret.
Well, Febben's now the next one in trouble. Spirit Rush defensively. Today I learned it's a retreating technique when playing against SK Telecom.
Well, it was a retreating technique for Faker earlier, even against Fnatic. So the RE pick in these games just hasn't been particularly spectacular. And I think we're seeing why it's just really not good to have this kind of priority right now.
Well, let's take a look as SKT inside the Baron pick for quite a while here. That Gragas ultimate didn't do much to help out Hooney there. And everybody pretty much just spread out here, but SK Telecom so far ahead, you can't get through the front line.
No Sejuani stuns available to lock down people in equalizer space. Renova's always preferred that Gragas over the Sej. This time round, maybe could have been the other way. Could have helped out more. 11,000 gold at 30 minutes. SKT now looking inhibitor turrets and Baron and Pop minions to help them out.
And what a series it has been. Blue side victories so far in all games. Power of the first pick between Fnatic and SKT.
It's been so interesting to see the rising stock of Rek'Sai throughout this tournament. As you know, when Cinderhulk was released, we did see a lot of these very tanky CC heavy junglers take precedent over some of these more fighter-oriented jungles. But this time around, we see how important that pick is with the way that a lot of these teams play in terms of their fast-paced openings and their love of skirmishing in the early game.
Yeah, I have to echo Crumbs again from the desk. He made a really, really strong point about Rek'Sai. The ultimate is used just to get back for more fighting. You never have to wait for cooldowns because her kit is designed, her basic kit. The pre-ultimate spells are all based around the early skirmishes and dueling. She's built for this series.
That's why she's had such high priority. Every single game, either picked or banned. I believe that continues the trend of 100% picked or banned throughout the mid-season Invitational.
You know who else doesn't really care that much about his ultimate? Nunu.
It's true, you're likely to get knocked out of that thing instantly anyway, so usually it's just there for a little bit of a temporary slow.
Hey, it's great at clearing minion waves.
Maybe we'll be lucky enough to see one of those. Take a look at the CS numbers. Nearly 100 separates Faker and Febben. Still massive disparities between jungle and AD carry.
Well,
Fnatic are just scrounging what they can.
At this point in the game, obviously SK Telecom is so insanely tanky that we have the two Frozen Hearts coming in, as well as all that HP. These burst mages that Fnatic is fielding, combined with the Sivir, simply aren't going to be able to do much at all.
You can't get position on this team. Zone control here. Talk about Nuna's ultimate. They've got so many different tools for controlling any pathways of entry into the battle. It's just so hard to break through the well-constructed battle lines that SKT have done every single game with the team comps that they've gone with.
Well, we'll find out if Fnatic can hold onto the inhibitor turrets. That is all that stands between Fnatic and SKT moving towards the finals. We do see Wolf, he goes in for the headbutt, Pulverize doesn't manage to connect. Bang, gets pulled backwards and the position reversal just for Yellow Star. SKT are very far ahead. Equalizer is pretty good. They knock Faker away. Is it enough for Fnatic? Febben did the best he can to zone away on the sidelines. Bengi's going low. Now Febben goes forward. There's no Mega Gnar available. That's a flash backwards. Fnatic may be able to win a team fight. Not without Rainover though. There, bang, re-engaged on the back line. Hooney's caught out. Hunter gets hourglassed away. We do see the mines coming out from Yellowstar, slowing them down, and Fnatic with a good last-ditch effort, but just not enough to get more than the front line of SKT. They do take Marin down in a 2-for-1, which is a phenomenal accomplishment.
Yeah, they're just so far behind in items at the point, even with almost the perfect start to that fight, where the full Alistar combo is blown on a minion. You know, they even dive the turret, you get extra damage. The swap was used on Yellowstar. Pretty much all good things happening, plus they land the ult combos onto Faker and take him almost all the way out. Even with all of that, the item advantage that SK Telecom have, very, very difficult to overcome.
Fnatic do live to fight another day. Mid turret not really being the focus, lost a little over a third of its hit points.
Well, I'm not surprised. Let's take a look at this again. And like you said, Kobe, you're going to see the Nautilus ult actually, I mean, Yellowstar does have a favor, actually gets him in range to ult Faker right there. There's the equalizer coming down and the barrel.
Oh, that flash.
And if Faker hadn't flashed right there, he might have died instantly and given the fight over to Fnatic before he could do any damage. Instead, Bengi's going to clog the choke right here and just back Faker up. They have a pink ward in that brush, so it's perfectly safe for Faker to stand in and fire out of. Uses his ult just for the slow, but starts to clean up this fight. And once Cassiopeia, this fight breaks down into all of these individual players, Cassiopeia will win all of those duels.
Well, definitely seemed to be the case in that scenario. Hooney gets jumped on by Marin. Febben trying to get some damage out over the wall with the Orb of Deception. Steal back, Spell Shield's down, Faker drops him! Twin Fang, two hits, dead Steal back. With no more wave clear, Fnatic are unable to defend the inhibitor turret. They will lose their mid lane inhibitor. And at 35 minutes, the final nail in Fnatic's coffin is being readied. It is being lined up. And Faker wants to be the one that drives it home. Two inhibitors down in the last 30 seconds. Are SKT confident enough to push for the finish or back away? Most likely the latter.
Faker is just so fed at this point. He's probably going to go for a QSS as his last item. Possibly a GA, I guess, as well, depending on what he wants to do. But he has this massive, nearly 100 CS lead over Febben as well. Febben took some shots trying to make some plays on the map. And the farm advantage now, pretty large.
I want to go back to what you were saying earlier, Monte Cristo. After 36 minutes of gameplay, Fnatic have still only secured one blue and one red this entire game of their own jungle buffs.
The level of control from SK Telecom this game has been extraordinary. And where was this the rest of the series as well? Because this is the right way to play against some of these very aggressive teams. And they've been a little hit or miss.
Well, SKT figured it out when it counts. They dug deep. Fnatic have gone to all five games in every best of five they have played in the recent times, but they were unable to adapt enough. The champion pools were tested to the limits. Febben was found just wanting at the end against one of the best teams in the world.
There is literally nothing that you can do if you are a jungler at your buff. You started your red side and the Nunu guesses that you started your red side because of what they see from the bottom lane joining with low health pools. If Nunu comes over, you have obviously already used your smite on the small camp that you started. All you can do is just watch as he takes your red buff from you.
I'm not being funny. The level of salt on this Nunu is ridiculous.
The only thing that you could do is use the rest of your team. It has to be a team effort.
You could make a highlight reel of Kobe's saltiness. But like, PTL, if you are listening, you could make a highlight reel
of Kobe's saltiness towards Nunu. Right, Rainover's going in, Rainover's going out. Wolf kicks him back. This could be the final fight. The Gnar locks him up against the wall. Yellowstar will be going down. This is the final fight for Fnatic, and it's SKT with a strong performance. Faker, explosive cast backwards. Petrifying gaze down. Double kill for Bang. Triple kill for Bang. Quadra kill for Bang. And Scumbag Marin denies the second pentakill.
And that's it. Marin's just going to teleport straight into the base, get the Baron buff. The surrender will come through, and SK Telecom T1 will move on to the MSI Finals.
What a series. A lot of respect between these two teams, all the way to five.
I'm very impressed with Fnatic.
Fnatic put it all out there this series. Such a close, close series. Great performance from all members. Steelback was taking a lot of flack. He showed up in the middle of the series. Back-to-back had some strong performances. Yellowstar was amazing on his engaged supports.
Don't forget Hoonie, man. You had some of the most crucial turnouts and things in this series. So for a team with these three rookies.
SK Telecom T1 are your first finalists at the mid-season Invitational. And my word, were they pushed to the limits.
How much have they shown now is the question. Do they have
all but Easy Hoon?
It's true. Do they have tricks left up their sleeves for whomever that final opponent is? Maybe they didn't want to play the Nunu in this series. Maybe that was something that they were going to be saving and making it look like they deprioritized a little bit.
Juggling has always been a team-based part of the game. And especially when the other team has something like, you know, one of those tools, you really have to incorporate everybody into that aspect very early on.
Well, Fnatic in a team huddle, they can definitely be proud of their performance. Almost everybody expected a 3-0 coming into today. I expected a 3-0 coming in today, and these guys made SK work harder than they've had to in a very long time.
Not only that, I didn't even expect them to make it out of groups. They've accomplished quite a lot here in the last few weeks in Europe and now here in MSI.
Well, amidst the chants of Hoonie, Hoonie, Hoonie from the audience, we'll be throwing to the analyst desk to wrap up the first.